Thank you all for your attendance and your interest. I want to sit down for a second and I'll make up something which is astonishing, or make an effort to do that. A lot of you saw the, did you, Raymond, see the presentation on LA and Vienna? You didn't see that. One of the oddities of architecture intersections in the world is this, of all things that might be connected or might not be connected, there is a peculiar but enduring association between Los Angeles and Vienna. Very recently there was a competition for a business school in Vienna. We had a show and we had a symposium, several discussions here and in the library gallery, which dealt with contemporary architecture questions. And then a piece of that presentation, Dana put together a brief discourse on Neutra and Schindler and the interrelationship of the two. So there is an enduring interest, I think, at SCI-Arc, not only in Richard Neutra, but also in Schindler, and some of you know Peter Milbrow and the Mac and the Schindler House, and all of there, there clearly is a connection and an interest on our part. Raymond, who is Richard's son and has a pedigree of his own in a different field, and I gather at a certain point of his life, certain point, maybe relatively recent, maybe more enduring, came to be interested in his dad's history and what seems to be a very personal way, and in particular, a house, which is a Silver Lake house. Was that your home? Did you live in the home where Raymond lived and grew up? And apparently that house has some physiological difficulties. It's owned by Cal State Pomona. And I think part of what Raymond is doing, and he did it at UCLA, and I think has done this in a number of places, is both to discuss the meaning, the long-term meaning of the building and its piece in the discourse of modern architecture, and also to proselytize a bit for interest which is translatable in financial terms, looking for support to keep the building in good shape. It's funny, when this just occurred to me, when I was a kid, my mother, I think I mentioned this to you, was working with your dad on a project for the Amalgamated Clothing Workers. You may know the project, it's downtown. They subsequently worked on it and changed it. So she was the client, and he was the architect, and there was a project that I was to do in school that had to do with what do you want to do when you grow up, which in my case was probably if you grow up. And she got the subject being of interest to me, and I went to see your dad in that house. And I remember walking into the house and talking to him and talking a little bit, which I subsequently reported on to all the kids who wanted to be football players. So there's something in this discussion which is, I think, personal to me, and in a way personal to all of us. One other thing which was of interest in a SCI-Arc sense, which has less to do simply with promulgating an image of an exceptional architect who was flawless, which is probably not true of any of the architects we know and love, and more interested in some of the tensions in his work, in his life, and particularly at looking back in history, the interrelationship between Schindler and Neutra, which is an unusual collision of ideas, of points of view, of sociological perspectives, and so on. And maybe you can say a word or two about that. Anyway, I'd like you to welcome Mr. Raymond Richard Neutra to SCI-Arc. We're happy to have him here, and we're very interested. Thank you very much.
So this is a personal perspective. I'm not an architect. I'm a retired public health physician and epidemiologist, and I was responsible for heading a big division that looked at environmental and occupational health in the California Department of Public Health until I retired a couple years ago. And Cal Poly Pomona asked me to help them fundraise and rethink how to program this compound that I grew up in and that was gifted to Cal Poly from their mother's death in 1990. By the way, how many have you been in the Neutra compound in Silver Lake? So about a third. Okay, good. So this will not be totally old hat to you. So what is it? It's really a triplex residences and architectural studio on a 60 by 70 foot lot in Silver Lake. And it was built in three stages, 1932, 1940, and then after a fire, part of it was rebuilt in 1966. So the very first part looked like this, built in 1932. Koos van der Leo, who is the patron of the Vanilla factory and found a flute residence in Holland, had heard my father lecture in 1930, and when he came to hear Krishnamurti in Ojai, stopped by and wanted to see the work that my dad had done. My dad took him to the local health house, and Father Leo said, now I want to see your house. And my father said, well, I live in a bungalow on Douglas Street, and I can't afford a house. You know, Father Leo pulled out his checkbook and said, how much do you need? And my father stammered out a number for a loan, which allowed him to build this, which from the beginning was conceived of as an if you like, a case study house. Low-income inhabitant, namely a poor architect in his family, where he, another person, and his office could all be. Had roof gardens, overhangs, awnings, lots of interesting features that I'll talk about. Then I was born in 1939, and they built another wing, completed in 1940, which was considered newsworthy. There, my mother is on the cover of the Los Angeles Times Home magazine. A whole wall would slide away open, and other interesting features. And this is what it looks like now. Then there was a fire in 1963 that burned down the upper two stories of the 1932 wing in the office with all the drawings and my father's books and manuscripts. And my brother Dion, who has inherited my father's firm at that time, was working with him, and they jointly redesigned on the very same prefabricated foundation this building. The original darkroom and apprentice rooms remain. This one has sun louvers, overhangs, water roofs, and a number of interesting features. And this is what it looked like in its heyday with a evaporative water roof, which now after 40 years is leaking, and that's what the problem is. So what is the significance of this compound? Like to call it a compound, not a house, because it was designed as a livable space. So, of course, this famous guy lived there. But it's also an interesting story about two immigrants who came in the 1920s and came from Switzerland and Vienna to Southern California in a very purposeful way. The rather interesting ideas of why. And you can see the experiments of this one firm in the 30s, 40s, and 60s. And you can look at the place where Gregory Ames, Harlow Harris, Raphael Soriano, Eric Schneider-Messel, and Norman Wexler, and many others started their careers working there. It was a cultural phenomenon for half a century in DNLP. And then it addressed trend-setting design questions. And some of these questions are still relevant questions that we ask today, you as architects ask. How can we achieve high-density, affordable, mixed use on a small site? How can we design landscape for indoor-outdoor living and emphasize the sight, smells, and sounds of nature? Accommodate climate through design. Use sustainable materials and technology. Inform design with biology and social science, and deploy all of this to serve the client's tranquility without conspicuous consumption of space, expensive materials, or craftsmanship, which had been a tendency in the previous generation. So why would my dad had that particular orientation? He grew up in an interesting family. His grandfather had been a physician but died in a typhoid epidemic taking care of his patients. And so my grandfather was essentially an orphan and had to become a machinist then get his children to become professionals. So one of my uncles was a psychiatrist, another was a patent lawyer, an aunt was an artist, and my dad, of course, an architect. And it's hard for us to imagine what it was like for him growing up in a place where Emperor Franz Joseph had been ruling for 60 years, that everything was run by dukes and counts and barons. And here he was reading about America, a very different kind of place. This is the neighborhood that he grew up in the second district of Vienna. It was then and still is a place where immigrants come and live. It's treeless, geometric, static. In his autobiography, he talks about what it was like to grow up in this apartment over here on the left. And he could look down the street and see the treetops of the Augarten. And that was a very different kind of experience. Sort of a treehouse-like experience where he stayed. And when I went there the first time in May of a couple of years ago, you could smell things, and birds were twittering, and breezes were blowing. And it was a completely different kind of environment when he was in that old apartment. And my father became very interested in physiology and the senses, and he discovered the psychologist Wilhelm Wundt in his textbook of general physiological psychology. So really what happened was he ultimately challenged the European relationship between the indoors and the outdoors. Apartment blocks, villas, peasant houses, you have this block that's kind of plunked in the garden without much. There's a cozy and isolated indoors and nature stays out. And when he began seeing pictures of Japanese architecture, this is not a mid-century modern California house. This was built when Sir Isaac Newton was a baby in 1640 in Kyoto. And then, of course, the Lost Muth portfolio. How many of you know what the Lost Muth portfolio was? So here it is. I'm holding it up at the Getty Museum. There are not many of these left. This one is Lloyd Wright's own copy, which was sold to Getty. Frank Lloyd Wright paid himself to have this portfolio made and published by the Berlin publisher Bosman. And in it were these kinds of sepia lithographs, which had been simplified from color renderings by Marion Mahoney, who later married Burley Griffin, and the two of them designed Canberra. And Lloyd Wright always thought that the white look of the international style was partly influenced by the fact of this simplification of what Wright had done. But this portfolio was dynamite for my dad and Rudolf Schindler, And around the same time, in Peter Barron's office, with Carpentier, Lewis, and Gropius took the day off to look at it. So that this was extraordinarily exciting to them, the way the indoors and outdoors related, the way the plan, the outside of the building read from the floor plan, the symmetry, the simplicity. And the other big influence was Otto Wagner's School of Architecture at the Academy of Fine Arts, which is running from the time my dad was 2 to the time he was 22. And it was unique in that it proposed to be problem-oriented, it proposed to use the new technology and materials, it proposed to do systems thinking about city planning and all the different kinds of building types other than monumental ones. And it was not supposed to have any single style. And it's recorded that when old Otto Wagner at the end of his career saw that bust with the portfolio, he brought it into the atelier and told Schindler and the other ones there, this guy is a better architect than I am. And this was the kind of student project that was being done in Otto Wagner's school, this particular one by Rudolf Schindler in 1913. And my father, who was studying down the block at the equivalent of MIT, would come down to see what the Wagner Schule people were doing, saw this, got to know this older student who was a senior when he was a freshman. And they also met at Adolf Loos's atelier, the guy who said the murder was a crime. So this kind of thing was being done in Vienna 6 years before the foundation of the Bauhaus, and well before Le Corbusier and Mies had done anything that you would consider modern. Indeed, judging by letters that my dad wrote to his fiance, my mother, to his mother-in-law, my grandmother, about trying to explain to them what excited him in architecture, he was talking about the multisensorial physical impact of architecture, what you smell, the breezes you felt, the echoings that you heard, and all the non-visual stuff as well as the visual. So I showed here 3 products. One, the wine bottle. We don't buy a wine bottle for how it looks. We buy it for what it does to all our olfactory nerves and our taste buds and the buzz that it gives us, right? And then the other letter that he wrote was with great excitement discussing a plan he was doing for an Englishman, and they were going back and forth about how to improve this, and he talked about all kinds of details of the performance, of where the piano should go so that you can get the right light on the score and not have glaring in your eyes, and not having the kitchen door swing open into the dining room and let the odors in and all this performance stuff. So the other object that we have here is a corkscrew, which we also don't buy for how it looks, but how it performs. And then finally, of course, there is the look. But early on, he was characterizing and looking at things in a way like modern industrial designers might think. Happy to look at the constraints of human physiology and human programming. So back to this house and all these attitudes, he now had a chance to exemplify in the studio residences, multifamily thing that he was building. And unlike its neighbors, it goes right to the boundaries, it looks inward to patios. In fact, that's the footprint as finally completed with 2 wings. The one, that wing is on Silver Lake Boulevard, that was the 32 wing, and then when I was born, it's 1940 wing, and this actually is part of that wing and doesn't connect to that. You get between these by these 2 patios. And I remember times when the economic times were lean, when we were living down here. Frank Wilkinson, who started public housing in Los Angeles, was living upstairs. There was another renter taking the place that Gregory Aim and his wife lived in, and then there was the studio in there. And the interesting thing about this is you could be in that small place and not run into other people, because there are three kitchens, three bathrooms, four bathrooms, and 12 exits. So that there are many ways that the people in this house can get out without bumping into the other people. One of the things that I think that my dad brought was the Viennese model of materials. Of course, the Baroque Viennese architecture is famous. And even Otto Loos, who said ornament is a crime, in building the Loos house here right next to the imperial court. Although it was simple, it's beautiful marble and bronze and clay materials. And when my dad got to this, it was a similar level of materials, but now we're talking about industrial materials. And in the Silver Lake house, these were materials like masonite, enameled metal, and other materials that could have been used in Lloyd Wright's housing. In that house, on the second floor, you have this radical indoor-outdoor kind of experience with a folding metal door going out to this porch with vinyl couches that you would sit around in nice weather, blue enameled metal walls. You get the roof line shooting out so that visually it seems like that's part of the roof. And this thing here is a strip light that at night lights it and keeps the mosquitoes out. The 1966 version is a similar kind of thing. And so I think there's a tradition of multi-story nature-near architecture that starts with Wright, and certainly Schindler and Neutra continued that. Here's an example that I love of a public employee retirement building in Sacramento, with jogging trails on the second floor and fountains. It's a great building that exemplifies this idea. This was applied to the first modern school in 1935 after the Long Beach earthquake. The patent for these big sliding metal doors, highlighter light. And in that 1940 place, there was one room. There was a family room that had a garage door that opened onto a about a 3 foot wide garden. Eugenia Hedge with the sidewalk on the other side. And as a kid, I wanted to give the tour of this place, and I would take pleasure in getting up to that door and whacking it with my hip, and this thing would just flip open and suddenly you have a garden right there. My father was interested in what water could do. The 1942 Nesbitt house with a pool next to the front door that goes under the glass inside to the house. Constant ripples and reflections, sounds, smells, and the VDL roof pool links to Silver Lake. You kind of have a borrowed landscape there, and the glass is set up to be reflecting on this. Accommodating climate with these louvers, with mirrored glass and overhangs in the back of the pool on the top. And a lot of attention and justification for how this thing was built in terms of the senses. So this is building and the sense world, a whole book devoted in German to this building and how it exemplified the thinking of the firm at that point. So there was kind of a biological explanation for the Japanese and Wrightian aesthetics at the VDL, with the notion that in Darwinian selection over millions of years in Africa, we were selected for a particular kind of temperate climate. That there are kind of, if you like, crucial vitamins that we need to understand to bring into the environment. Change, stimulation of all the senses rather than a static, deadly kind of thing. And that you could supply those vitamins even in space or in the desert if you understand what crucial ingredients were, because you can't probably build a Japanese garden space that far. And the notion that understanding of biological reasons for things avoids problems and suggests new solutions and engenders respect for just what a complex being we are. So there's a kind of a moral commitment here that everyone has a right to these nature's vitamins, everyone has a right to an environment that meets their practical, social, psychological, and spiritual program, that this can be achieved on a small footprint, this can be sustainable and climate sensitive. So now the future of this building. Kyle Polly has owned it since 1990. It's managed by the dean, and there's a resident director. For the last couple of years, it's been Professor Sarah Lawrenson and her husband David. We're interested in restoring it, maintaining it, having it be a place that informs and serves. And I like to say that while Le Corbusier said that the house was a machine for living, this place ought to be a machine for inspiring possibilities as opposed to being a machine for remembering stuff. And as I say, the mission is restore, maintain, and then inform degree-granting courses that relate to this, and I'll show you a few of the things that Cal Poly is doing. Professional continuing education there, educating the public about landscape architecture, architecture, urban design, and then serving as a venue for conversations and for policy making. I think that this is the kind of place that the arts organization that wanted to do strategic planning would like to spend a day, have a nice lunch, and breakout areas and roof gardens and patios and places where people can get together. And then a venue for intimate music and small events, because my mother was a musician and there was a lot of music in that house and there was a wonderful piano. But the problems that we faced when we first came to this was that there were roof leaks, and we have dealt with two of those roofs. Marble Ambassador has given us pro bono help in doing working drawings for that. But we still have that water roof, which is going to be $120,000 to it. And there's another $500,000 of other things. Sliding glass doors that don't completely open anymore, louvers that motors broken on, all kinds of things like that. And we had no funding to support the program director. There was uncertain funding about how we would pay the electric bill and the insurance. And we needed to clarify the governance, how decisions would be made on an ongoing basis, and how a major restoration would be project managed. But we've made a lot of progress in the last 2 years. We created a Friends of the Neutra VDL research site that has an active planning task force, including people from LA Conservancy and the National Trust, and several people in the movie industry that are Neutra owners. Then we have an honorary committee.